morning. We're Ken and Barb Wardius. We're from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and we're here this morning to talk about our latest lighthouse publication. It's called Wisconsin Lighthouses. It deals with all 48 lighthouses in the state of Wisconsin. This book was several years in the making. It's actually a revision of a book we published first 15 years ago. It's totally revised, new photography. We teamed up with the Wisconsin Historical Society to redo the history, update the history. Many lighthouses have changed their status in the last decade or so. And also we were able to use a lot of the archives, the black and white, those beautiful black and white photos that the Historical Society has in their archives as a supplement to the modern color pictures.
Machine can hear him.
The book is available from us today. It's also available on Amazon or Barnes & Noble. We also have some other books that we've done. We'll talk about it in the presentation. We've done some individual lighthouses right here. My Vanna White's pointing them out for you. We've done Cana Island in Door County. We've also done Wind Point in Racine. And then in our hometown, North Point, Milwaukee Lighthouse. And those are also available from Arcadia Publishing, Barnes & Noble, or Amazon.
We're happy to be here in Sheboygan Falls again. We were here, it's a long time ago, but thank you again for the invitation. We look forward to doing the presentation this morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
13 years ago, end of 13 years, these folks were here to open their first book, so it's sort of amazing.
Yeah.
Thanks for inviting us here.
We were much younger then. This is really sad. I was in my 30s when we started. So I think we will just turn over the microphone to them and we'll talk after a while, okay?
Sounds good.
Thanks.
Thank you, Bill. Good morning. Thank you, folks. Thanks for coming this morning. You'll hear a little bit of a repeat of what we just talked about on the TV, but thank you for the invitation to come to Sheboygan Falls again. Pretty town. Barb and I love the cities along the coastline of Lake Michigan, so thanks again for the invitation. What we're going to do in the time that we're here this morning is take you on a tour of our latest adventure. This is a totally revised edition of Wisconsin Lighthouses. Barb and I have been fortunate to produce 5 different books. This is a totally revised edition of a book that we published nearly 15 years ago. I mentioned before, the difference of this book, not only is the cover different, all the color photography, there's 100+ images of color photography. They're totally different than the first edition. The narrative, the text has been updated, changed in some cases. We found a few errors in the first book that we corrected, but even the text, 100 and I forget how many pages, a lot of text was totally revised. Our publisher for this book is the Wisconsin Historical Society, and we were just thrilled to partner with them. Not only with their expertise, but one of the biggest changes in the book is it allowed us to have access to their archives. Barb and I love the old photos, the old black and white sepia archival photos. You will see a lot of those today, and they're interspersed in the book throughout. So we're really pleased that the Historical Society and we were able to collaborate on this. What we'll do in the time that we're with you this morning, there's 48 lighthouses in Wisconsin. We would be here the entire day if we talked about all of them, but we will touch on a great number of them. What we'll do is we'll probably talk for about 45 minutes. We'll take a brief break after that, and then we'll finish with some additional lighthouses. Some of the lights hopefully will be familiar to you, and some of them hopefully also will be new. Along the way, there's certain to be questions or comments. If you could hold those after the second portion, we open it up to questions and answers. We always enjoy favorite lighthouses of people, lighthouse stories. We don't claim to know everything about Wisconsin's lights, and we always learn something at presentations like this. The program's going to start with some music. We'll take that intermission, as I mentioned, after about 45 minutes or so, and then we'll finish up the second segment, and that will also conclude with some music. I was talking to one of the gentlemen, if all of this technology works right, everything will go smooth. So we'll dim the lights and take a trip to see Wisconsin's lighthouses. Okay, away we go.
The state from the Ashland and Bayfield area. We came down to the Bay of Green Bay, Lake Winnebago, and then all the way down the coastline of Wisconsin. I'm going to begin our tour though today on Lake Superior. This is the largest freshwater lake in the world. Some of the most beautiful scenery in our state is found here as well. And with the opening of the Sioux Locks in 1855, this portion of Wisconsin was the very last to be settled.
The first lighthouse we'll talk about this morning has Wisconsin in the title. This is the Wisconsin Point Light. It sits outside the city of Superior. Last year, it celebrated its 100th anniversary, being built in 1913. As you can see from this photo, it's not the easiest lighthouse to get to. It sits on the end of a very long, rocky breakwater. Wisconsin Point actually is a sandbar. Across the channel, there's Superior, Duluth, the state of Minnesota. Across the channel, Minnesota Point, which is the same sandbar, and Wisconsin Point actually make up the largest freshwater sandbar in the entire world. This is our daughter, Sarah, about 15, she's a teenager here. This is mom and I, Barb and I, and Sarah, as a family, we're fortunate to go to a lot of these lighthouses together. Here is a photo of Sarah as a teenager smiling. Parents in the audience probably realize that going to lighthouses with mom and dad as a teenager is not at the top of the list of what they want to do. So we took a picture of her smiling, and we're very fortunate to be able to do a lot of these as a family. Most lighthouses throughout the world were built in response to commerce. A century or more ago, wooden schooners would have plied the Great Lakes. Today, these modern metal super tankers still come and go from the Duluth Superior Harbor. But historically, when goods were moved by ships, there wasn't the modern railroad system yet or the modern highways that we enjoy today. Things were moved by boat, and the reason lighthouses were built primarily was to let Mariners know, you know, this is Superior, this is Milwaukee, this is Sheboygan. Various beacons were constructed, harbors were improved. A few lighthouses were built because of specific hazards to Mariners, shoals, rocky areas, but most were just to identify various ports. One thing we learned about Wisconsin Point, it's again a very modern harbor to this day, big freighters still come and go from it. In November of 1975, the giant ore carrier Edmund Fitzgerald left the Duluth Superior Harbor, passed by Wisconsin Point. All lighthouses are automated. The beacon flashes 24 hours a day, every day of the year. Little did the 29 men on the Big Fitz realize that in less than 2 days after they passed by Wisconsin Point to open Lake Superior, the entire ship would have sunk on the eastern end of Lake Superior after it battled for hours a massive late fall storm.
When Ken and I take our cameras out and do all of the photography that we do, we like to go at different times of the day to add interest to our work. One of our favorite times of the day is sunrise, which means you've gotten up well before sunrise, and it also means you're set up at your location well ahead of sunrise. It also means you might be in the wrong spot. You're not quite sure exactly where that big orange fireball is going to be. And our one morning in Superior, this was the case. It meant picking everything up and running down the beach as fast as we could, which wasn't very fast. And we had about a minute to take this shot, and the sun was behind that huge cloud bank, and the rest of the day was cloudy and overcast. We were very, very lucky.
We definitely had a lot of help along the way here. We're going to, going back to the map now, we're going to move from Superior to the northeast, and this area is called the Apostle Islands. The Apostle Islands is a national park. It's called the Apostle Islands National Lakeshore. You can see from the map there's quite a few lighthouses in this area. There, in addition to Ashland and Superior, there are 8 lighthouses in this national park. There are more lighthouses here than in any other national park. If you've ever been to Bayfield, it's a beautiful town in northern Wisconsin. People come to vacation, relax, enjoy these outcroppings of rock, and they also enjoy lighthouses. The only way to get to the Apostle Islands lighthouses is by boat.
And our first stop here takes us to the Sand Island Light, built here in 1881. Much of the history of Sand Island comes to us from the Lewick family, who served here for about 30 years. And you might think being on an island location, it was just that family, the Lewick family. This is Ella and Emmanuel Lewick. Fortunately for the Lewicks, there was a fishing village at the opposite end of the island, so they had other families and other people to socialize with, so not quite as remote as many other island locations. This is the only Apostle's Light built of locally quarried brownstone. I think it looks a little bit like a gingerbread house, and on any given day, if you ask me what my favorite lighthouse is, this is definitely in the top 10 or so. I can never pick for sure, but definitely in the top 10.
When Barb and I and Sarah visited the Apostle Islands lights years ago, we visited all 8 lighthouses in a single day. don't do that. We were on a fairly tight time schedule, but we rented a water taxi. Many of you know that the levels of the Great Lakes over the last decade or more are lower than what they used to be. So the boat driver could not tie up right by Sand Island because of exposed rocks. He put Sarah and I, and eventually Barb separately, in this sea kayak. He said, get as close as you can to the shore. Sarah's laughing here because she knows that I'm not the most steady guy.
She knows you're getting wet.
We're going to get wet. But he said, you know, it'll be maybe a foot deep. You'll find a path. And then there'll be a volunteer at the lighthouse. So we did jump out of the boat into the water. This area is called Lighthouse Bay, actually. Not real original, but that's where the lighthouse was. You've probably heard stories, too, about how cold Lake Superior is. This is the middle of the summertime. Again, only about a foot of water, freezing cold. Absolutely true. This is Mary Ann. She was a volunteer at Sand Island for a number of weeks. The National Park Service has volunteers stay at the lighthouse to give tours, to do housekeeping. We were fortunate to talk to her. She obviously led us in the lantern area here. This is a modern plastic beacon. Most or all lighthouses are automated. Most of them have these plastic beacons. We'll talk about Fresnel lenses a little bit later. But we took Mary Ann's picture. She told us a lot of history about Sand Island, and we unfortunately had to say goodbye, and we're on our way. If you live along the Great Lakes like most of us do, be it Sheboygan, Milwaukee, Lake Superior, you know that the weather forecast is, you know, it's kind of a guess and a guide. Weather can change quite abruptly. This was Sand Island when we first arrived. It's cloudy, but the forecast for the day was fine. About a half an hour later, the fog rolled in. We were headed out to Devil's Island, an outer island, ran into a nasty, very quick, but very strong summer storm. Should not have been on that part of Lake Superior that day. We were blessed. This area that I mentioned before, Sand Island, we just discussed, is on the western side. This is called the West Channel. The next lighthouse we're going to visit is just a couple of miles away, called Raspberry Island. Historically, when ships came and went from Duluth, Superior, and other harbors to the west, they would use these lights primarily as their guide. So now we'll visit a little bit further to the east of Sand Island is Raspberry Island.
And Raspberry Island is the most visited lighthouse in the Apostles. And I think the reason for that is not only has it been renovated to the period of the 1930s, but it's also the closest. So if you want to take a bit of a shorter boat trip, this is the one to take. It is currently staffed by folks that work for the National Park Service. And as you hop off the boat, they'll tell you, welcome to the Berry. The flower gardens and the vegetable gardens have been restored to the period. The inside of the home as well has been restored. It's quite the showplace of the Apostle Island lighthouses. And this is the original lens that sat at Raspberry Island back in the 1800s. It's currently at the Madeline Island Historical Museum on Madeline Island. And if you ask, they'll turn it on with the lights and make it all colorful for you. It's quite beautiful. And this is not a lighthouse. This is the modern plastic beacon that provides the light today at Raspberry. We never call these lighthouses because they're not. Definitely not. And here's what she looks like with a new paint job. And many of you may have heard over the years about all the erosion on the bluffs in the Apostles. Here they're actually doing some bluff stabilization. This took place over the period of about 4 or 5 years as federal monies became available. They did Outer Island, they did a lot of work at Devils, and this is what it looks like today, and there's actually some grass and things growing now where all the burlap is, and all the lovely rocks. It's much, much safer for the lighthouse so they can keep her open for many, many years. And had you been a keeper here back in the day, you made a whole $400 a year. That's why you had a vegetable garden. And you probably have maybe a cow or some chickens as well to supplement your meals.
Back to the map now. We had just discussed the West Channel. We're going to go to the east and talk about there's two lighthouses on Michigan Island. And this was the when ships came into Ashland and a small port called La Pointe, they would use this Eastern Channel, and there was a need for lights in that area as well.
Our first stop here is the Michigan Island Old Tower. This is the first light built in the Apostles in 1857. And we've read several accounts of why this lighthouse is here. One said the contractor misread the map, and another one said the contractor listened to the locals who said, put it here. It's supposed to be on Long Island further to the south. It did cost him dearly. He had to build a second light on Long Island at his own expense. This is called a New England style lighthouse. And we've been asked, did you take this from a hot air balloon or even an airplane? It's taken from the widow's walk or parapet of this next light.
There are actually two lighthouses on Michigan Island. The one Barb just described is in the lower right-hand corner. It's called the Old Michigan Tower. Mariners were complaining in the 1800s that it was difficult to see this lighthouse. As you can see, it's not very tall, and actually some of the trees historically started to grow. And instead of chopping the trees down, the U.S. Lighthouse Service had a surplus light on the east coast of the United States. They disassembled it, reassembled it on Michigan Island, and the new Michigan Tower was put in its place. So there are two lighthouses on Michigan Island. This is the oldest one in the Apostles, all eight, and this is the newest one in the Apostles, 1929. This was the last light we visited on our whirlwind tour of the Apostles. Our daughter Sarah sat at the stairs, the base of the stairs here. She says, "I'm not climbing any more stairways with you folks. Thank you very much." She missed out on that gorgeous view that we showed a couple of slides ago. Not the easiest light to get to the top, to 138 steps. We count steps. We're kind of silly that way, but it's fun. By the way, this is the second tallest light in Wisconsin. It misses being the king of all lighthouses in the Badger State by just 1 foot. We'll talk about the other one later.
And leaving Lake Superior, we're going to travel to Lake Winnebago. This is our largest inland lake in the state of Wisconsin. When we began researching lighthouses, we were very surprised to find 4 lighthouses on Lake Winnebago, so more work was called for. And many of you know Lake Winnebago, even though it's very large, it's not that deep, maybe 21 to 22 feet at its deepest point. But even today, recreational boaters still use the lighthouses to guide them or let them know exactly where they are. These are the 4 lighthouses on Lake Winnebago, and we'll actually discuss in detail 2 of them.
The first one we'll talk about on Lake Winnebago has one of the most peculiar sounding names of any light in the state. This is called the Asylum Bay Lighthouse. It's outside the city of Oshkosh. All of the lights on Lake Winnebago are on the western shore. The light gets that name. Actually, the word asylum has a couple of definitions. It means refuge. There's a mental health complex in the area. We assume that years ago they used the word asylum as that facility. Certainly don't do that today. But that's where the name probably comes from. This is a relatively new light. Not a lot of history is known about it. It dates back to 1940, not 1840, but 1940. This is what it looks like today. The Parks Department in this area spent a few thousand dollars within the last 5 years to renovate the top and shore up some of the windows and the brickwork. This lighthouse is situated on an island that has a footbridge. It used to be called Lighthouse Island. It was also called Picnic Point. And in the 1940s, the Wisconsin Conservation Commission had what was called a rough fish removal program on Lake Winnebago. Sailors would use the light from Asylum Bay at night, go out on Lake Winnebago, and harvest carp and sheep's head for markets in the Midwest as well as the East Coast. We were not able to learn a lot of history about this light. Generally, when we do our research, one of the primary resources of historical material are local public libraries. Wonderful resources for that kind of material. When we're in the Oshkosh, Fond du Lac area, we did go to local libraries. Not a lot of history on Asylum Bay. We were not able to find, in fact, when it went out of service. We saw conflicting information that it had an electric light. Others said, no, it was never electrified. So we need to go back to the libraries and see if we can do some more digging for material.
And this is called the Rockwell Light. It's actually built where the Fox River empties into Lake Winnebago. It's a privately owned light. This is actually in someone's backyard. It's named for its architect and designer, George Rockwell. But history has told us that over the years, whoever owned the point would name it after themselves. Why wouldn't you? It's your lighthouse, name it your lighthouse. William Bray was one of the first owners, and he called it, of course, Bray's Point. And there are newspaper accounts that he would entertain friends, colleagues, and even President William Howard Taft came to lunch. They were responsible for the care and lighting of their privately owned light every night, of course, at their own expense, as well as paying taxes on their privately held light. And the owners, the keepers there today, still do the same. This is one of those great old archival postcards that we've gotten from the Historical Society. One of our favorite things is to see something like this. And this is what the Rockwell light looks like at night. She sports a red beacon.
We're going to leave Lake Winnebago now and journey to the very far western shore of Lake Michigan, better known as Green Bay. As you can see from the map, quite a number of lighthouses in this area of the state. Many of them are out on islands. A few of them actually used to be on an island, and they've been moved to the Green Bay Yacht Club. We'll talk about that in a little bit. We'll also tell you where the name Green Bay comes from. Barb and I are big Packer fans. The bay was named before the Packers, sorry.
Our first step here takes us to the Green Island Light. Green Island is located 5 miles offshore of Marinette and Menominee. And take a look at the design of this light, because we're going to discuss it in detail a little bit more in a little while. Logbooks tell us here that Samuel Drew was the first keeper of Green Island, and in his logbook entry he says, "Son Frank born today under the light." And indeed he was born at the lighthouse. This is his son Frank, who became chief keeper at Green Island in later years. We know for certain he was a chief keeper because he sports K for keeper, and even the brass buttons have lighthouses on them.
He was quite the dapper gentleman in his uniform. This is the Drew family tombstone, and Frank Drew, the Drew family, was a very dedicated group of people. Actually, others in the family were lighthouse keepers as well. Even after Frank passed away, he could not get away from a lighthouse. The family headstone has an engraving of a light. That's actually very appropriate. When Frank Drew was buried, the pallbearers for him were assistants and keepers from various Great Lakes lighthouses. I mentioned before, there's many examples where husbands, spouses, children, uncles, brothers were in the lighthouse service many times for decades and decades. This is, again, one of those just wonderful photographs. In addition to having access to the Wisconsin Historical Society archives, over the years, Barb and I have been fortunate to meet up with descendants of lighthouse keepers. We met the lady on the left about 10 years ago. This is a photograph of her and her sister on Green Island. This is the Dresden family. Keeper Dresden and his wife and two children were stationed at Green Island for a number of years before it was automated. This lady came up to us in Milwaukee years ago. We had a lighthouse presentation. She introduced herself and she said, "I'm the daughter of a lighthouse keeper. I'd like to talk to you." And our eyes got, you know, huge. And she lived in a suburb of Milwaukee. We went to visit her. She pulled out the family photo album from the 1930s and 40s. She said, "Copy these pictures. Take them. Get them back to me whenever. I'd like you to have them." That was typical of lighthouse families that we met. Very willing to share history, documents, photographs, just wonderful people. As a side, like, this is Virginia on the left, Virginian Dresden Smitty. She is a spry 90 years old today, sharp as a tack. Unfortunately, this is what Green Island looks like today. It actually looks worse than this. This photograph is a few years old. The government ultimately automated Green Island. They abandoned it years later. There was a fire, there was vandalism, and just the elements, the weather took their toll. Green Island, with without any people on it, became overgrown. The buildings fell into disrepair. This is what passes for a light on Green Island today. Again, certainly not the traditional lighthouse that has the people stories. We're going to move now to a little bit further south in the Bay of Green Bay. This is what the southern end of the bay looks like in the middle of the summertime. It's a thick pea soup green. This is where Green Bay gets its name from. This is one of our favorite towers. Granted, it doesn't look like a whole lot. It's been decapitated. It doesn't have a lantern. This is the ruins of what is called the Tail Point Lighthouse. It sits on the end of a sandbar. Years ago, this was a very important light for Green Bay as well as De Pere. It dates back to Wisconsin, first came a state 1848. The locals still call this the Old Stone Tower, and we were able actually to eventually find out that there were three lighthouses in this area. The government in the mid-1800s, the bay level was quite high. It was actually at the very base of this tower, and the government was afraid that the lighthouse was, the base was going to be compromised and would eventually topple into the bay. They hired a contractor, and with the tools of that time, their job was to knock the stone tower down. You can see from the rocks and the brickwork here, that might be a little bit more difficult than they had imagined. And again, with the tools of that time, probably, you know, chisels, hammers, pickaxes, fortunately, they were not able to knock Tail Point down. This is what it looks like from the inside. Looking up, this huge crack is probably where the circular stairway was. When we went to the local libraries to research Tail Point, we actually saw, it seemed like about every 10 years or so, people would say or predict that Tail Point was going to fall into the bay. We are happy to tell you that never happened. We met another lady who was a lighthouse keeper's daughter just by accident. We got an email about a year ago from a lady that saw our book in the Milwaukee airport. She said, "My mother is a lighthouse keeper's daughter. She lives in Waukesha. Her daughter lives in, I think it was out east somewhere. Would you like to talk to her about her days at the lighthouse?" Certainly, you bet. So we were fortunate to meet up with her. This is a photograph that she allowed us to borrow and to copy. This is the second Tail Point light. It's the more traditional looking light with a tower. This is her father, Andy Weber, who was in the lighthouse service for about 30 years, then later in the military. He served in the lighthouse service a total of over 40 years, about 30 years of which were at Tail Point. The lady on the left is Adris Weber Robinson and a friend of hers when they were graduating from high school. This is what the Tail Point Beach looked like when it was taken care of, and there was a lighthouse and just people, the presence of people and fishing and what have you. This lady on the left of the right-hand photograph is 89 years old, was just willing to, she had put together some notes, pages and pages of notes of her life as a teenager at Tail Point. Those kind of, that kind of information is priceless.
Well, now you know we don't own a boat, so we wanted to get out into the Bay of Green Bay, and someone suggested we contact the yacht club, which Ken did, and they said, "We'll call Merle. Merle has a boat. He likes to go out just for fun." So we set a date to meet Merle, and he said, "Just park your car and you'll see my boat. It's called the Toscana. His boat is a 40-foot yacht." So we had a four-hour tour of the Bay of Green Bay, which was lovely, from a complete stranger. Here I am working on the book.
You are not.
I am too.
You are not.
I am working on the book. It was a lot of work, but it was a lot more fun, and we met the nicest folks along the way. And now we're going to go to one of our favorite places. This is Door County, Wisconsin. And many of you know that historically, hundreds of shipwrecks have occurred here. All of the shoals that you can't see and all of the rocky outcroppings that you can see caused havoc back in the day when schooners plied the waters here. And the Door Peninsula is just this thumb-shaped piece of land that stretches out into Lake Michigan. But Door County can claim one of the highest concentrations of lighthouses of any county in the country. There are 11 lighthouses here. So if you're a lighthouse enthusiast, this is the place for you.
We're going to journey now to one of the more difficult lighthouses, maybe the most difficult lighthouse to get to in Wisconsin. If you look at the map, chances are you know where we're going to go. We're going to go up to the Pottawatomie Light. It sits on Rock Island. If you go to the end of the main Door Peninsula, Door County gets its name from this body of water. This is called the Death's Door Strait. Barb and I decided to hop on this boat. We're going to go part of the way to Rock Island. A little town here was called Northport. We're going to pass by two other islands that have lighthouses, Pilot Island to the east and Plum Island, smack plum in the middle of Death's Door, has a range light system that we'll talk about shortly. We went around those islands, got to Washington Island, got our way up to the northern end of Washington Island. The way to get to Rock Island is on this smaller boat called the Carfi. If you've ever been to Rock Island, chances are you've pulled up to this gorgeous, gorgeous boathouse. This used to be a private citizen's island years ago. An industrialist by the name of Chester Thorderson, eventually he and his family gave the island to the state of Wisconsin. Rock Island is now a Wisconsin state park. We are still a mile and a quarter away from the Pottawatomie Light. The ranger told us what path to take. He said you'll go up and down some hills, in and out of some woods. Eventually there will be a clearing. After about a half an hour, Barb and I are still in some woods and we're wondering, did we take the wrong path?
No.
But the clearing finally came into view, and this is what we saw about 15 years ago. Again, you can see there's something missing here. There's no lantern. This is what Pottawatomie looked like before a group called the Friends of Rock Island got an idea to restore a lantern, a beacon in the tower, as well as to renovate both the grounds and the interior. Quite the undertaking. This site, actually, there were two lighthouses at this site. The first lighthouse, which is no longer erected, dates back to 1836. About 20 years later, many of the very earliest lighthouses were not built that well. Some of the brick was faulty. A lot of the mortar was compromised. So the government, after about 20 years, demolished that one, and in 1858 put up the structure that you see here today. This was a very important area in shipping years ago. It was called the Rock Island Passage. Even today, recreational boats use this modern tower that's just down the path on Rock Island from the lighthouse, but certainly not a lighthouse.
We had the photo you saw that had no lantern in it, and before we went to press the first time, the Friends of Rock Island were posting information on the internet, which was just coming into its being at that time, and Ken was saying, oh, we have to go back and get an updated photo with the lantern that they're putting up there. So this necessitated a day trip from Milwaukee, where we left about 3 a.m. and got the first boat over and caught the first Carfi over. And as luck would have it, once again, the Friends of Rock Island were on the Carfi with us. And of course, they have the key for the lighthouse. Would we like to come in and see what their plans are? Would we like to come in and climb the tower? Well, sure, I won't knock anybody over on my way to be the first to climb. We were very, very lucky to meet up with them, and we've kept in contact with them. They've done a great job. They're just a wonderful renovation. And we've actually recently come upon this photo from the Historical Society. This dates to 1905, a young man and his horse delivering wood to the Pottawatomie Light. A long walk.
That photo actually, and this modern one, really gives you a sense of how the times have changed. All the modern conveniences that we take for granted today, modern road system, electricity, hot running water, indoor plumbing, indoor toilet facilities, all of that was not present at Pottawatomie. And today, Barb and I are fortunate. The Friends of Rock Island open up the lighthouse from spring through fall with a volunteer program. You stay at the lighthouse for a week. You are the volunteer keepers. You give tours to the public. You do housekeeping between the spiders and the flies. It keeps you going. After everybody is gone, you know, mid-afternoon, you have the lighthouse to yourself. Generally, you're doing a lot of the cleaning that you know, had happened during the day. But it really gave us a sense, with still no electricity, the source of water is out in the yard. There's a hand pump. Not against, you know, pumping some water, but it gave us a sense. A lot of times people have this idea that the lighthouse era was this just glamorous, romantic, just grand time. It was a lot of day-to-day hard work, hardworking lighthouse keepers and their families. Really gave us a better sense here with no electricity. There is a modern composting toilet outside, which by today's standard, that's compared nice to an outhouse, is really nice. There's refrigeration through a propane refrigerator and a propane stove, but you have to heat your water up. If you take a really quick shower in the yard after everybody's gone for the day, kind of a spongy shower, it really gave us an appreciation of what lighthouse keepers endured over a century ago.
And we're going to move to the mainland now, back down towards Bailey's Harbor. This is called the Old Bailey's Harbor Lighthouse, and this obviously is a very, very old photo from more than 100 years ago. And as Kent and I wanted to visit the old lighthouse, we learned a little bit too late that this is a privately owned lighthouse. If you look at this lantern, it's very different from anything you've seen yet this morning. It's called a birdcage style, and you can certainly see why. And we understand the owners here have applied for some federal money to hopefully shore her up. It's in really, really rough shape. The tower is pretty good, but the lantern definitely needs some work before it falls over into the bay. Mm-hmm. All right, another day, another boat trip. Check it out. Ken's got waders. I don't. Luckily for me, some fishermen came along and said, well, just take Lars. This is the lovely red boat that's behind us. They pointed at me. They said, you get in. They pointed at Ken, and they said, you pull.
To give you an idea of what that scene, well, it really didn't look like this, but there was a movie called The African Queen with Humphrey Bogart and Katharine Hepburn. There's a scene in the movie, Barb certainly isn't dressed nicely like Miss Hepburn, but Humphrey Bogart is pulling this boat through the jungle, and that's not exactly how it looked, but we had fun.
That's not how it looked. And don't let him tell you how he trudged across the strait of water. It was a very narrow strait of water. It wasn't very deep, but wouldn't you know it, the boat was leaking. So I told him to hurry up, and you can imagine what he told me. And after that, he said, pick up the gear. Well, as we landed on the island, we learned that no matter where you land on an island location, the island contains the lighthouse at the opposite end of the island. So we began walking around with all of our gear, and there were a couple of, I'll call them gentlemen, out in a rowboat, and they said, where are you guys going? And I'm real excited. I said, oh, we're going to see the lighthouse. They said, that's great, you're trespassing. This is private property.
Uh-oh.
And I'm thinking, okay, this is going to be the end of our lighthouse adventure. They're going to gun us down, and no one will find our bodies. But luckily, they didn't. Luckily, they didn't. But they just said, take your pictures, please, you know, and get off of our island. Okay. And as they paddled away, they said, beware of the large dog that roams the grounds. Are you kidding me? Really? Here he is. And he wasn't roaming. He was peeking out a window, so we took a picture of him. We took a few pictures of the lighthouse. I think we were off that island in 10 minutes flat. We left a business card, but they have not invited us back.
Actually, the Old Bailey's Harbor lighthouse that we talked about, it's the oldest one on the peninsula, but it did not have a very long life, actually less than 20 years. It was located in a very poor position. I mentioned early on that most lighthouses were built to allow mariners to know that this is Bailey's Harbor, this is Sheboygan. This light was built to warn mariners of the shoals in Bailey's Harbor, very treacherous ones actually. and it didn't do a very good job. They didn't put it in the right spot. So they abandoned this light, and in its place, they put two lighthouses in Bailey's Harbor called a range light system, which we'll talk about shortly, and a very large coastal light to the north called Cana Island. These are the Bailey's Harbor range lights. Again, one of these marvelous historical photos. A range light system is generally two lighthouses. One is taller than the other. One is significantly farther away than the front one. This is called the front range light. These date to 1869. This is the one in the background. And what mariners do, Bailey's Harbor has a lot of shallow areas and rocky shoals. This is on Plum Island, but this is a range light system. There's a shorter light in the front, a taller light in the back. When you line these up exactly straight, the mariner knows that's the path, the safe path to follow into Bailey's Harbor. So the photo of those two, the schoolhouse in the back had a lantern up here. The short one in the front had lantern here and in the back. This, by the way, is the shortest lighthouse in Wisconsin at only 21 feet. But when those two were lined up, mariners knew this was the right line. It was called being on range to safely come and go from Bailey's Harbor.
And there's a lot more about the Bailey's Harbor range lights. We learned that Joseph Harris Jr. was a keeper here, but his father was a proponent of the Sturgeon Bay Ship Canal, and he was the editor of the Door County Advocate, so he was a pretty powerful man, and eventually they did build the ship canal. Little did they know, though, that that would really impact Bailey's Harbor negatively because the ships weren't going past there anymore. So they lost some business. The towns never became as big as they had hoped they would become.
This is another one of those great old photographs. This is one of the keepers at Bailey's Harbor Range Lights. This is Henry Gady and his wife Eve. He was in the lighthouse service for over 25 years. Just at Bailey's Harbor. They were a very well-known couple. Generally, lighthouse keepers were looked up to. They had what was considered a prestigious position. This is Keeper Gady with his, I believe it was a Buick. He's got his lighthouse keeper's hat on with the insignia on it, and they would come and go through Door County when they were not in service at the light station. Sometimes people think, you know, being a lighthouse keeper was, you know, it certainly was a lot of work, a very regimented, much of it was, you know, government rules and regulations. This is Keeper Gady in the background with his friends. If you blow this photograph up even further, they're drinking Miller beer, having looks like cigars and Miller beer. So socially, a lot of lighthouse families did a lot of things together. Again, these old photographs, just they tell stories for a long time.
Eventually, though, the range lights were converted to acetylene gas, and then the keeper from Cana Island was responsible just for checking on the lights periodically to make sure they were working. And if he missed that cue, the mariners would certainly let the lighthouse board know that the lights were not working properly. And eventually, they were electrified in the 1930s and then became part of the Ridges Sanctuary. So if you've been to the Ridges, you've been to the lighthouses. They've done a great job here. And this is what they use today. It's called a day mark, and there's a beacon at the top of the day mark. So that takes the place of the range lights. Even though the range lights are still in place, they are no longer used. We have this lovely orange and white panel in the front to guide us into the harbor. And restoration efforts began here a couple of years ago. They wanted to move the lower range. It was located very close to the road. So they were having lots of problems with, as you can imagine, in the wintertime, all the salt and everything being plowed very close to the base of the lighthouse. So as of last winter, they began the project to move her inland just a little bit further, which they did. And then she received a much-needed paint job. You saw the previous photo. This is much better. All cleaned up, all shored up, and ready to go.
This will be the last lighthouse we'll touch on before we take a brief break, and the last one in Door County. I mentioned before when the Old Bailey's Lighthouse didn't have a very long life, three lighthouses were actually used in its place. The two Bailey's Harbor Range lights that you just saw, and a very tall coastal beacon called Cana Island, just to the north of Bailey's Harbor. Cana Island is the tall, classic white tower and keeper's quarters attached to the lighthouse. If you close your eyes and you think about a lighthouse, chances are maybe you wouldn't be too far from this picture here at Cana Island. Again, 1869, the same year that the range lights were put into service and the same year that the old Bailey's Harbor went out of service. Cana Island is 86 feet tall. It actually is a brick tower, but you wouldn't know that from the outside metal sheeting that the government placed on it about 30 years, around the year 1900. After about 30 years of wear and tear, they realized the brickwork was weathering. Cana Island is an exposed piece of land. The brickwork was weathering faster than they wanted, so they encased it with this sheeting that still surrounds the brickwork today. Cana Island, this is where Barb and I first got interested in lighthouses about 40 years ago. We would vacation in Door County. Some friends of ours said, "Have you ever been to Cana Island?" For whatever reason, we hadn't. We went there, fell in love with the place, wanted to learn, not just to take more photographs of it, but wanted to learn about the people, the keepers, and Cana Island's story. Cana Island is unique in a number of aspects. This one has to do with its lens. This is a French-made, hand-polished prisms called Fresnel lenses. Cana Island is the oldest original still operating French Fresnel lens in Wisconsin today, again 1869. Years ago, before the Door County Maritime Museum and the County of Door took over the lighthouse, you could not get in the tower. We were fortunate to talk to the Coast Guard back then. This was before 9/11 and all of that stuff, so it again you needed special permission. We were fortunate to get in there in the winter time when the Coast Guard had a little bit more time. Any photographers in the audience, we had a wide angle lens on our camera. We were as far away from the lens as possible. It stands about 5 feet tall. This is only half the lens. You don't have to be a physicist or a rocket scientist to figure out how Fresnel lenses work. They revolutionized lighthouses throughout the world. There are a series of dozens of these hand-polished glass prisms. You have a light source in the middle of the lens, and all of the light rays from that source go out in every which direction. And Jean Fresnel figured out with all these different angles on these prisms that these different rays could be bent and they could be sent out magnified in one direction. So you can imagine all of this goes through the lenses and the magnifiers. If you're out on Lake Michigan, all of the rays of light come out towards the lake. This revolutionized lighthouses and lighthouse lenses throughout the world, not just in Wisconsin and the United States. Mariners could see a much brighter beacon, and they could see it for many more miles. Barb and I go to Door County a few times a year. We always try to get to Cana Island. This series of pictures shows you different times of the day we go, sometimes at night. The lighthouse now is open routinely with the Door County Maritime Museum. The tower can be accessed if you want to go up the stairway to the top of the tower. It's got one of these gorgeous circular stairways. We've even been there in the wintertime, not this past winter. It's just too nasty, but it is. It's like a postcard. You can go there different times of the day, different seasons. Barb and I wanted to learn more about the history of Cana Island eventually after the first book was published. This is the only known photograph of Cana Island with the brick tower. This is one of those 1930s photos of the keeper with his dog and an assistant at Cana Island. These photos are just marvelous. This is Keeper Conrad Stram. Just these beautiful, beautiful pictures. He was in the lighthouse service over 40 years, some of them at Cana Island. He also was on a lightship on the Great Lakes. So we didn't have enough to do when Barb and I were working and raising a family. We decided to write a book on just on Cana Island in our spare time. We're going to take a brief break. People want to stand up, stretch your legs for a few minutes before we settle down the rest of the coastline of the state. That was a good start. Thank you very much for coming today. Thank you.